Stéphane Aubavier, thank you so much for having me here at the ACE System headquarters in Paris. So you're the Chief Operating Officer, but before we get into your role and what ACE System is, I want to just talk about where you grew up and how you got into the nuclear space.
Yeah. First of all, thank you for welcoming us.
Yeah, of course.
I know that you have interviewed some of our mates already during the last days. I hope it was good. I love the way you pronounce my name, by the way.
Great. Thanks. You coached me a little bit. It was helpful.
Maybe just to start answering your first question. I mean, I'm an engineer, mechanical engineer from a French engineering school, and then I had a graduation as an MBA, meaning that I'm a kind of strange animal for at least the European engineering world, where most of the engineers are pure 100% engineer.
Right.
I'm a kind of hybrid.
Did you do engineering for a couple of years and then decide to get your MBA?
Yeah, exactly. I started my career with Assystem, with the company, as commissioning engineer.
And what's a commissioning engineer? Because in the US, we don't really have an equivalent.
Well, a commissioning engineer is somebody who takes an installation, for example, a power plant,
mm-hmm.
let's say a power plant or a final assembly line in an automotive industry, and arriving when it doesn't work and leaving when it works, according to the requirements.
Great.
It is a way.
Yeah.
So I started my career as commissioning engineer both in automotive industry and nuclear industry with Assystem. And then after 7 years, I quit the company to make my MBA degree. And I joined another company called ABB, so a vending company, a vendor, for a couple of years. And when I was trained and properly experimented, I came back to Assystem to lead, in fact, the development of the nuclear activity.
So what made you, during your time as a commissioning engineer, think, okay, now I'm going to go back to school and get an MBA? Did you want, you know, your own company, or what was the...
No, I mean, the point was being a commissioner. I mean, I started to be a commissioning engineer, and as I was complaining always after the design and the construction delivered, the company I was working with started to tell me, okay, if you are complaining that much, please take over construction management, and then you will not have any reason to complain. So I started to cover all the side phases of the projects, and then I was still complaining against the design. So some of our customers of SM say, okay, so now you will run the overall project. And when I started to run the overall project as project director, in fact, I realized that probably I was more comfortable with the marketing and the sales issues than the technical one. At least I was more interested in those activities rather than in the technical ones. And then I thought at this time, I was still quite young, I was 27, something like that. I thought that I was lacking of finance and mm-hmm. management capabilities. So it was basically the reason for which I went back to school to university to have that degree.
Yeah, and mm-hmm, go ahead.
No, and I'm happy to have done it. As a matter of fact, I think that it was just a way to reassure myself on my abilities to do different things.
Yeah,
that's it.
It's always good to have a diverse skill set.
If
you can
understand
the engineering, but also do the management and the finance and oversee the whole project, that's how projects get done.
Yeah, it is.
So what were some of the things that you were seeing at the time in terms of the construction and the design that you wanted to change?
Well, the point is that I think that especially according now to the capabilities given by all the digital tools, we have more and more abilities to manage, in fact, the requirements on the project. And when we discuss mm-hmm. about projects, could be in automotive, could be in nuclear, it doesn't change that much, actually.
Mm-hmm.
It's all about the management of the requirements.
I mean, requirements like the law, like the regulations?
I mean the regulation, but as well the operations expectations you have, the performance expectations you have on the plant, whatever it is, and the use of the overall industry, and including, in fact, the engineering companies, is basically, first of all, to start with specification and to make a design.
Mm-hmm.
And that design, of course, has to fit and to match the requirements of the project, but as well is always a way for engineers to demonstrate the technical capabilities of the company. Meaning that what we could see in almost all of our projects is that the design is running the project at the beginning, at least, and most of the time too far in the timeline of the project, being governed by more willingness to make and to design a nice performant object rather than to design something just fitting with the requirements, the basic requirements of the project.
Mm-hmm.
And when we talk about nuclear, of course, we all think that when we talk about requirements, nobody forgets all the regulation ones.
Mm-hmm.
But regulation is one thing. Of course, it's important, it's compulsory when we are in nuclear, but the power station is not designed to fit with the requirement of the National Safety Authority.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's done to provide, to supply some power, some electricity on the grid. I mean,
right.
This is basically the purpose of a power station. And then the point, as we have the tools to do it now, is that we could be more clever in the way, in fact, we design a power station according to the basic requirement of the project. And what we learn as an engineering company, and what I learned myself being a commissioning engineer and then a project director on some project, is that when you switch to the site phases, when you switch to the construction phase of a project, in fact, you have to stop pushing the project ahead with the design, but you have to pull the project from the end, meaning that as soon as you deliver the design and you switch to construction, the point is not any longer to try to figure out what could be the best plant you can have. It's just to make the construction and then the commissioning to make the plant running as fast as possible, as quick as possible. And it's a different mindset you have when you go from the design phase to the construction phase. And even the way to manage the project is basically different. It's why on the project we run, most of the time, we change the project management team when we switch from the design phase to the construction phase.
Interesting. So that you're almost saying, okay, you guys can't design anymore. We're going to give the whole project to somebody else, and they're not allowed to change the design. They just manage the construction.
Yeah, because in fact, the project management, when you are in the design phase, I mean, they still, and even when the design phase is supposed to be finished, to be completed, the management is still thinking what they have not done, they would, I should have done during the design phase, sorry. And then it's very difficult from a pure behaving perspective, in fact, to as you change, you have been through that milestone of the beginning of the construction, to change your mindset, stopping to push the project with more and more design and modification to make, in fact, the power station even better.
Mm-hmm.
But just say, okay, no, we matched with the requirements, so now we stop the design. And okay, maybe we could have done better, but it is not the point. We have done good. It's more than enough. And then to manage the project then in a very different way. I mean, just trying to cope with what has been designed, not still thinking about what we could do better than we have done. And time to time, you can find out some people able to make that bridge. It does not happen so often, in fact.
Yeah.
I mean, you have to just change your mindset in the middle of the project. Okay, I mean, we are just all of us human being. It's not as easy as that to do it like that, in fact. So most of the time, it means that the consequence for an engineering company is that most of the time, if we want to have the project successful, meaning being at cost and on time, in the middle of the project, at the moment you have almost completed the design, you have to switch with a different team that will be only concerned with the delivery of the project.
Yeah, this strategy, I can tell, comes from an engineer and businessman combined in one, because it is very much giving, you know, the opportunity for your engineers to design, to be creative, but to still meet
exactly.
the requirements that they want, but then to say there's a cutoff point. You can't just keep designing until the last day that the structure is built. And
exactly.
It's genius. No. Yeah, I like the switching of the management team.
Yeah, exactly. And it's why, in fact, you cannot melt, in fact, the project management and the engineering. Is that if you melt the two of them, in fact, you do not keep that ability to assess, in fact, the result of the design, just comparing the design result with the requirement of the project, and not to assess the design, trying to reach the best design you can have on that project. So the split, the segregation between, in fact, the engineering team and the project management, and then the segregation in the timeline of the project during project management team for the design phase and for the other one is, according to our experience, in nuclear, as it is in some other industries, is absolutely mandatory to reach the project on time. And if we consider now most of the new build projects we can see worldwide, and we take part to in the world, the main reason of the difficulty of the nuclear industry to match, in fact, the timelines of the project is related to basically two issues. The first one is that in some cases, the commitment taken to tackle the contract are not realistic, meaning mm-hmm. that the what is signed at the beginning anyway will not be reached. That this is for sure. And in some of the case, and in almost all the cases, the lack of focus on the ability to deliver the project compared to the focus on engineering of the project and design of the project, mm-hmm. the balance is not the good one.
Yeah.
Most of the team are in the main nuclear industries. I mean, we work with in the French, with the French one, with the Russian one, with the Korean one. I mean, is very focused on engineering and design and very concerned with the quality of the design.
Yeah.
Putting, in fact, as a second priority, the need to match, in fact, with the timeline. And then not concerned so much on the way, in fact, to deliver on time the project. It comes from the fact that most of the big vendors right now in the nuclear industry probably are mainly operators. They are not pure engineering company. They are not project-oriented companies. They are operators. Mm-hmm. So in the back mind, they have all the time the assessment of is what I deliver is the best nuclear power plant, the best new NPP I could have to operate it well. So it's a natural, I mean, wondering you have when you are an operator, which is fine. When you sign for EPC contracts, you don't care. Of course you care, but to an extent. I mean, as soon as you match with the requirements of operability, safety, and cost, okay, that's fine. I mean, your design is good, and then you have to deliver your project. So that issue of mindset, which is a very soft issue, it's not a, an it's not a big deal. It's a pure matter of behavior of the constructor is key to make a nuclear project successful and is, according to me, in fact, the main challenge the nuclear industry has to face during the past decade and probably during the coming one.
Yeah, I completely agree. And I mean, as you say, it comes from a lot of experience and learning from all the past projects, because there are a lot of companies in the nuclear space right now that aren't doing this, and you see the consequences of it. So from your experiences, you know, you've been with A-System from the start of your career. Was there ever, you know, one sort of moment or one period of time where you started to realize this idea that we need to just completely separate the engineering and the construction management parts of the project? Or was it a really gradual realization over time?
No, I mean, for us, it has been, frankly speaking, it has been gradual, as especially for me, my personal history is going along with the one of A-System. Mm-hmm. And then as A-System started to be a commissioning firm, we were specialized in pure commissioning. We were hired by the customers to go on projects, on difficult projects, where in fact the plant was supposed to work and was not working. Mm-hmm. But then we have been upstream in the project gradually, in fact, starting with commissioning and going upstream to a construction management, then to design and at some point of time to run the overall project. So as we have been all along that road, gradually we identified, in fact, the difficulties of the project. But as we are born not as a design company, but as a commissioning company, mm-hmm. the focus we kept all along was to deliver the project on time.
Right.
So, and I see a major gap between, I mean, a cultural gap between, in fact, our company and some of the ones more focused and born in design. Is what you are born in design, they are born to do the best. When you are born in commissioning, you are born just to deliver the project.
Right, to
sell. Don't care about the rest.
Yeah.
And then, clearly, I mean, there is not one day when I woke up and realizing that you have to make that, to balance, in fact, the project management between the design and the site phases is just the result of the learning curve of the company where, I mean, going upstream in the project and now starting from very early stages of the project. Okay, we understood that as we made mistakes as well.
Right.
And we missed the targets on some projects and analyzing why, in fact, we realized that the main leverage we had on the project to be successful was to have this kind of change in the way of managing in the mindset of the people managing the project between the design phase and the construction.
Yeah, no, that's really great. And I think that'll set you guys apart and really help push the nuclear industry forward, because you'll get a lot of new builds on time and on budget. And then, you know, it'll propel the industry forward. You just have to prove it a couple of times that your method works. And then you got a system going.
Yeah, because in fact, the point is that to deliver, in fact, your project at cost and on time, the best way is to copy and paste.
Yep.
In fact,
mm-hmm.
it's not to reinvent. And then saying that you copy and paste means that you reduce the design as the minimum you can. And it's difficult to ask that to a design firm.
Yeah.
Because in fact, their business is to make a new one.
Right.
So in you have a kind of antagonism in the requirements you have to be successful on the project between those two things. Is that, as a matter of fact, to manage your project properly, I mean, you have to limit the design as much as possible. It's not the purpose of the design firm.
Right.
And if you consider, in fact, the economy of a nuclear project starting now, probably about 15 to 20% of the cost of the project is related to the construction cost itself.
Right.
To the capex.
And most of the construction cost isn't of, say, the core, it's of the facilities surrounding.
Yeah. But in fact, the point is that the capex is not the main part. If I just try to break down the cost of a megawatt, in fact, you have 15 to 20% of that cost, which is related to the capex. You have about probably 25%, 30% related to the operation cost, fuel, labor cost to operate, cost of maintenance, and all the stuff. And you have something looking like 35-60% related to the funding of the project.
Right.
The cost of funding, if you try to break down the cost of funding, about 75% of the cost of funding is related to the risk coverage on the project.
That's huge.
It's huge. So if you discuss with any operator worldwide right now, everybody will tell you a quite similar story as the one I'm telling you, is that for the timing, the issue, it's not a surprise. We all know that. The issue is not for the timing the ability to make the project, is the ability to fund the project. Mm-hmm. And the difficulty to fund the project in nuclear is that the cost of risk, I mean, considered by the investors, is huge in nuclear for two reasons. One is the safety issues and the risk on operations. And the other one is the risk on construction. If you want to diminish both risks, the best way to do it is from one project to another one to copy and paste. Because from a pure analytic perspective, if you copy and paste, meaning that you keep the same design, you keep the same supply chain, you construct the same way, then automatically you diminish, in fact, the risk of the project. It means that when we say that, the way to consider a nuclear project now is not any longer to try to see, to consider the project with, first of all, a design phase and then a construction one, is to consider the project with a first phase, which is not a design phase, but which is the how the definition of the project tending to diminish as much as possible innovation, creativity, and then design on your project. And then you have a design phase where you try to change the fewest things as possible compared to the last similar project you did. And then to make the construction with the same supply chain you had on the previous project. I think that one of the main risks we have now in the nuclear industry is to have gaps between two projects where you lose, in fact, your supply chain and where you cannot capitalize on the previous project done.
So that makes me wonder, because I think a lot of people go into engineering because they want that sort of ingenuity and they want to get to play around with different designs. So how do you sort of train and convince your engineers to think with a more business mindset and to have a cutoff point?
Because in fact, the recruitment we have on our engineers is that we do prefer to recruit engineers that are more attracted by the project management rather than from the design, for the reason you just mentioned. Meaning that those engineers will be more naturally focused on the delivery of the project, whatever are the contents of the project, rather than on the design phase of the project, where in fact you have to be creative somehow, meaning that it's the reason for which, if you consider the footprint of the company and the location of our engineers, most of our engineers are on site.
Mm-hmm.
We have small design offices, big enough to sustain, in fact, the business we have, but most of our teams are on site.
That's great.
Working on what we call, field design, the adaptation of the design to the site and validation of the design of the constructors, of the EPC contractors. But most of our team are on site for project management, construction management, and commissioning. And we do prefer to hire those kind of people as, in fact, they are more focused on the delivery of the project. And then one of the main thing we try to coach our engineers on is basically to be more focused on the customer and more focused on, I would say, what is happening outside the company rather than what is happening inside the company, staying behind, in fact, the desk. And for us, it's key. I think that the success of the company is probably 80% related to that, to the fact that all our teams are very focused on the customer satisfaction. And the best way, in fact, to make your customer happy is, first of all, to deliver on time. Yeah. And so it's an absolute focus of everybody to do that.
Yeah, that's a great strategy. And why don't you tell me a little bit about the structure, like the setup of ACE System as a company as a whole? So you guys are a French company. And so how was ACE System started? What's your main goal? And what does your employee base look like?
So for the time being, ACE System is a company gathering about 6,000 people. We have our main footprint in Europe and Middle East. We have around 60% of the activity in Europe and about 40% in Middle East. When I say Middle East, it's a very large definition of Middle
right.
East, starting with Egypt and finishing in Uzbekistan and let's say the Middle Asia. We born in 66 as a commissioning company. We have been created at the beginning by us. We are a spin-off of a governmental body in France called CA that was dedicated in the mid of the 60s
mm-hmm.
on the research on nuclear activities.
Mm.
And we have been created by four employees of that company in 66 to make the commissioning of all the nuclear plants in France. For power generation, for fuel cycle topics, or for a defense one, we have been created in 66 to commission all the plants, the nuclear plants in France, and sold by France abroad. In China or in South Africa, for example, in the 70s and the 80s. And then started like that, being not a public owned company, but being a private one,
mm-hmm.
we started to consider, how we could, in fact, diversify in other verticals where you had similar issues than the one we faced in nuclear. Very compelling environments where you have a strong regulation,
mm-hmm.
a lot of technology involved, lots of one of a kind, very complex infrastructure projects. And we started to develop in some, other industries. We reached mid of the years 2000, a size of about 10,000 people. We made the decision to sell, in fact, 60% of the company in 2017 to refocus on nuclear. 60% of the company.
Wow.
In 2017 to refocus on nuclear.
Mm-hmm.
As we
and
are.
Why was that? Why refocus on nuclear?
Because, in fact, we are still a family-owned company.
Mm-hmm.
We are owned by the founder, who is the chairman of the company. And so as we develop activities in a lot of verticals, we thought that to keep on growing, we have to consolidate, in fact, different markets, leading us to make different kind of acquisitions.
Mm-hmm.
And then as the shareholder doesn't want to be diluted, then we have to make a choice.
Yeah.
We could not keep on being a key players at the same time in automotive and aerospace and in a nuclear and a complex infrastructure project. And then why did we make the decision to choose to keep in fact nuclear and to refocus in nuclear rather than focusing on aerospace and automotive? The reason is that first of all, we come from our background is that kind of complex infrastructure project. Mm-hmm. So it's what we like.
So it's more sort of a challenge for
you? It is. Yeah. It's basically what we like to do. And so it's a part of the, it's one of the irrational, I would say, reason for which we make that choice. The second one, which is more rational, is that we are deeply convinced that if we want to fight against climate change, then you have no other solutions than increasing parts of the power supply coming from electricity. And then if you want to have green electricity, mm-hmm. you have no other choice than developing, in fact, your nuclear footprint, as all the renewables industry are still not regular one, not steady one. And then if you want to have, especially for the big countries, we all think about the countries in North America or in Europe, but as well for the fast-growing countries, such as, of course, China, India, and some other ones, they have no other options than erecting some nuclear facilities if mm-hmm. they want to balance, in fact, the CO2 emissions. So keeping the ability to develop their local economy. So we had that conviction that probably the best days of nuclear are in front of us. Mm-hmm. We develop, in fact, our footprint in Middle East and Asia because, of course, we have less challenge in that part of the world to accept nuclear industry than we have right now in the Western countries. So it was a way for us to develop our activity. We made a lot of efforts to develop our collaboration with the Russian industry, as if you consider the project, international project now ongoing in nuclear worldwide, I guess that 75% of them are led by the nuclear Russian industry. So mm-hmm. As soon as you don't work on domestic market on big countries such as China or US or France and Japan and Korea, where you have local nuclear industries, as soon as you go on kind of export projects, especially with new coming countries accessing to nuclear, Russia has 75% of the project. So it was quite obvious for us to start to collaborate with the Russian industry, what we do currently. So when we look, when we consider the future of the company, still for at least 2025, I mean, our business plans or design for about 5 years, on a 5 years period. If we look now to 2025, we think that we will still grow of 50% in nuclear to this time. Mainly, of course, dealing with the projects we have on the new built and existing fleets, and the support to the existing fleets in Europe, in UK, in France, but a lot as well, and mainly actually with the new build projects coming in North Africa, in Middle East, and in Asia.
And I'm gonna ask you a lot about those projects in a second, and sort of the markets that you guys are going into. But first, when you talk about, you guys sort of had this conviction that climate change was going to be a really important topic and that nuclear was going to be the way to sort of address it. What was the stage like at climate change at that point in time? Were people actively paying attention to it and considering it as, something that is real? Or were you guys ahead in that sort of thinking?
Well, is the climate change real? I think the answer is yes. I think that it will be difficult to to argue with that or about that. I mean, the climate change is coming, and global warmth is a reality. Then, what are the consequences on the first of all, the opinions, the public opinions, and the different governments? Does it affect, first of all, the energy consumption? The answer is no. If you look at, it's a US body, in fact, as a matter of fact, who published that kind of study in the past months. If you consider the growth of energy consumption since 1900, mm-hmm. you see that the energy consumption is the growth is exponential.
Yeah.
And so thinking that you will reach a point where with a strong inflection of that when you consider the trend
mm-hmm.
and when you see in fact what were the how the growth was affected during the two world war, the first one and the second one, as a matter of fact, it does not affect at all the energy consumption in any part of the world, even during the world war.
Crazy.
So the energy consumption
mm-hmm.
is still growing like hell.
Yeah.
So all the plans that are related to the a way to cap or to diminish the energy consumption
mm-hmm.
in Western country basically will not work. And even if it was working in countries populated with 70 or 80 million inhabitants, when you consider the growth somewhere else, in countries populated with 1.5 billion or 1 billion of inhabitants, you see that globally, from the world perspective, energy consumption will still definitely grow during the next century.
Right.
So it means that, yes, we have global warmth. Can we drastically limit the energy consumption? It looks, unfortunately, that the answer is no. Meaning that we have to consider how is it possible to produce energy not affecting too much the earth.
Right.
Then, on those two things, energy consumption trends and the way to do it, to produce energy, it looks that there is a huge discrepancy between what is said and published and advertised by the different countries, by the governments, and the thinking of a public opinion, and what both the people and the government are actually doing to do it.
Why is there a discrepancy?
Well, first of all, lots of Western governments think that they can limit energy consumption.
Mm-hmm.
This is the consequence of looking at the world, thinking that the world is yourself.
Mm.
And it's we can explain it as when you are the government of France or Germany or UK or US, you are just the government, you are just running and ruling your country, not the rest of your neighbors.
Right.
And then, okay, you cannot make decision for the planet. I mean, you make decision where you can, when you are allowed to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have no global thinking and no global management on what is the profile of the energy consumption in the world in the coming century.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's so not much
Kyoto or COP21 that mm-hmm. change anything. I mean, you have no global concern of that kind. So everybody thinks that at his level, he will do something that will change the world. I'm afraid it will not, in fact. Yeah. And the second point is that it's quite a difficult topic to explain to the public, to the people,
mm-hmm.
As we live in a world where, in fact, technology is more and more important. But if you consider the scientific education of the mm-hmm. people, it's getting lower and lower.
Right.
And so we spend our whole days running things we don't understand.
Mm-hmm.
And when you, as soon as you talk about energy, electricity, nuclear, those are difficult matters, hard to handle if you have not basically a scientific education.
Mm-hmm.
So it's difficult, the communication between all of us, with the governments, with the people, and so on, is not easy because you have a huge technical hurdle to go through.
Right.
Saying that, I don't say that the people are not able to understand, is that the people who are in charge have to find a way to make understood those things by the public opinions. Yeah. And then, for the time being, you have huge paradox in the way, in fact, the energy policies are run in the different countries, where, in fact, I mean, we have, for example, a survey, and the French public opinion is not basically against nuclear.
Mm-hmm.
We had a survey about 2 weeks ago in France regarding nuclear acceptance. And one of the questions was, does nuclear has CO2 emissions?
Hmm.
60% of the French population mm-hmm. thinks that yes.
60% think yes.
60 thinks that nuclear generates CO2.
Why do you think that so many people think that it generates CO2?
Because, in fact, they see chimneys.
Uh-huh. Like the smokestacks?
Yes. Well, you have steam getting out.
Right.
Well, they think it's CO2. That's it.
Yeah.
That's it.
They think it's smoke and not steam.
Yeah, it's smoke. it looks like smoke.
Yeah.
So this is CO2. So it means that as we run nuclear power station for 40 years, still 40 years after, people do think that nuclear generates CO2. So, and for one reason, it has never been explained, in fact, to the people somehow.
Yeah.
So one of the issues we have is that kind of paradox where everybody is quite sincerely concerned with the global warmth,
mm-hmm.
but at the same time, still have wrong belief on what is generating global warmth.
Right.
And so as soon as you are not aligned in that, it makes quite difficult to make the good decisions.
Right.
And it's a real challenge we have, I think, in front of us, and the next generations have in front of them, is that if we are not able to have enough transparency and sincerity in the way we make our life consistent with the challenges we have and the way we do it, we face it, it will be a mess, basically. And mm-hmm. and it's if I had the solution, I would be very happy to propose it, but I'm afraid I do not have. But it is a challenge. And
mm-hmm.
as we speak now, as of today, I mean, the problem is that we have too much discrepancy between the understanding of the challenges
mm-hmm.
and what are the way, the means, the leverage we have to actually act on those challenges and try to mitigate them. Mm-hmm. So big challenge for us, I guess.
Yeah, and I think that even though those challenges exist, one thing that a lot of people, and it seems like a system is doing, is sort of circumventing those challenges by building nuclear and designing nuclear for countries that are already really willing to accept it and to use it, you know, right away instead of sort of waiting for public opinions to come forth. And so on that topic, you know, what are some of your collaborations with other countries and how do you see using the copy-paste model on a global scale?
Well, I mean, we are very happy to work with countries such as Egypt or Saudi Arabia or United Emirates or Uzbekistan and Turkey to, first of all, assist the governments and public bodies to develop their nuclear programs according to the AIEA regulation, first of all, and then to assist, in fact, the industries in charge of building that project to be successful, trying to use and to limit the change in the design, but at the same time to matching the local requirement of the safety authority.
Right.
And so this is the ambiguity, in fact, and the challenge that all the newcomers have in nuclear is that on one end, they have to develop their own nuclear culture and their own standards, mm-hmm. most of the time inspired by either the European one or the US ones. And at the same time, to try not to make a new reactor each time we build a reactor in a country. So there is a balance and somehow part of our involvement in those projects is to try to mitigate, I mean, to reduce as much as possible the gap between the local requirements mm-hmm. and the design proposed, in fact, by the different vendors.
So I know it's not your area of expertise, but why should we even have local regulations? Why shouldn't we just have like global regulation of the nuclear industry?
No, I mean, we could have a global regulation of nuclear industry as long as each country is using it. Mm-hmm. The statement today is that you have different regulation. They are not 100% different between the different countries. But then, even though you have the same basic regulation between the countries, the legal environment in each country is different. Mm-hmm. And then it means that it will anyway, to some extent, affect the nuclear regulation. I mean, the responsibility and liabilities, are not defined the same way in all the countries, and it has some consequences on the nuclear regulation. Mm-hmm. So it's difficult to have it 100% similar. We could reach a point, we could envisage to have global standards. For the time being, it's not the case, and I'm not sure it will come in a near future, as each nuclear industry in the six main nuclear countries has been set up accordingly. Mm-hmm. I mean, according to the local capability. So now, I mean, changing the regulation in the big country having huge nuclear fleets, mm-hmm. it is not so easy and so obvious. So the convergence of the system is difficult between, I mean, if we just talk frankly, I mean, when you consider US, Canada, France, Japan, China, mm-hmm. okay, you have significant parts of the nuclear reactors running worldwide. So as you have so many reactors running, trying to find a common regulation now is not so easy because it would affect, in fact, the different reactors you have operating in the different countries too much. So mm-hmm. it's not so easy for the timing. But anyway, even though we consider that we have ASME, RCC, for example, and EUA. I mean, the standard encodes, most of the main one we use in the world, converging. We will still have some specificities related to the local legal environment of the different countries.
Mm-hmm. So then when you guys are looking for countries to partner with and to work with, do you start by looking at their regulations, or what's sort of the process for a system partnering?
No, in our case, yes. I mean, the first thing when we collaborate with a country, we are not specialized in assisting the country to build and to set up their own regulation,
mm-hmm.
Meaning that we arrive, I mean, we take the regulation as it is.
Right.
But the first thing for us, of course, is to understand, I mean, what are the specificities of the regulation? And then, according to the technology chosen by the country, could be to assist them to select the technology they will use on the country. But if the technology has been chosen already, and it happens in most of the time, by the way.
Why would they already know which technologies they want?
Because in fact, you have, two things. The first one is that in some cases, the choice of the technology is driven by the bilateral agreement you have mm-hmm. between countries
mm-hmm.
and the ability to a counterpart to fund the project. So you have significant part of the projects for newcomers in the world that come from bilateral agreements. So you have no call for tenders. Mm-hmm. So you have no bid. So the technology is chosen by definition. And in some of the cases, you have a call for tender and a selection of the technology. As system is French, we are not supposed to be 100% independent, mm-hmm. even though we are independent from a pure capital perspective.
Mm-hmm.
But we do not take so much part to that selection process as we could be conflicted having a strong relationship with EDF in France, meaning that we come most of the time after, or we deal with issues not related to that selection. And when we come after, it means that the first thing we have to do is to understand, is to measure what are the gaps between, in fact, the design proposed for licensing
mm-hmm.
and the requirements of the local national safety authority, and then to try to mitigate for the interest of both parts the gap between regulation and design, as I was saying. Mitigating that gap is the best way to make the project successful, mm-hmm. as the less you innovate, the better will be the delivery of the project.
Right.
So this is the reason.
Yeah. And have you guys found that sort of with that strategy of less innovation and sort of more of a construction and budget in mind, that there are certain types of reactors that work better with that style of engineering over others?
As a matter of fact, when you have differences between the big, I mean, first of all, when you talk about type of reactors, now PWR,
pressurized water reactor,
yeah, it covers 99% of the new build programs worldwide.
Mm-hmm.
So, for the time being, we talk only about PWR. You have few projects with BWR, and all the new ones are most of them. They are all of it, PWR. Between the different PWR technologies, of course, I mean, US, French, Russian, Korean, Chinese, you have some differences,
mm-hmm.
not that much. We just have to keep in mind that in France, the PWR we have is derived from the US one. In Korea, it's exactly the same. In China, it's derived from the US one and the French one. So you have very similar concept of basic design concept on PWR. You have some differences, but say they are not that big regarding the design.
Mm-hmm.
Then in the construction, from a construction perspective, you have some differences. What we see is that almost everybody try to converge with similar concept in a PWR, as everybody wants to reach about the same level of safety, Gen 3 standard safety in the design,
mm-hmm.
and try to lower the cost of construction as much as possible. So it draws everybody to have similar concept. It means that in most of the cases we see right now, the selection of a technology from a country, of course, I mean, the technology is considered, but as the difference, or I would say minors, if I say that, I mean, some of the vendors will disagree, I'm sure, as the difference are not major, if I say it a different way,
yeah.
In fact, the choice of the vendors is more done on the ability to fund the project,
mm-hmm.
and to take over risks on the construction and time to time on operations. So we are a bit far from the technology perspective.
Right.
So are there major difference from one technology to another one for the construction and so on? Yes, you have, but can we say you have one technology is far better from the other one and so much easier to construct than the other ones? The answer is no.
Right.
So it's the capability to manage the project and to focus on the requirements to be fulfilled and to do as less job as possible that makes the difference.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. And so in going forward, what sort of markets is A-System going to focus on? Are you guys really going to stay in the Middle East and Europe, or do you think you guys are going to try to expand even more?
No, I mean, we for the 5 coming years, yes, we will still focus on Europe and Middle East and minor Asia. When I say minor Asia, I have to mention India as a specific topic. So those are the countries we will still focus on. We have some question mark about Canada, assuming that Canada will go for a new build projects,
mm-hmm.
and that's it. I mean, we are not considering Chinese domestic market or US domestic markets, as we have so strong and good competitors there that it does not really make sense for us to try to step in those markets where, in fact, I'm not 100% sure of what we can bring to those markets. And we have
mm-hmm.
lots of job to be done anyway in Europe, Middle East, and Asia. So for us, the main target will remain those ones in the coming years.
Yeah. And as we wrap up here, what's your vision for the future of nuclear? What do you hope to see in the next 20 or 30 years?
Well, I think that what I would like to see in 20 to 30 coming years, first of all, is to see the same focus of the operator on the safety of the operations, which is massively the case worldwide. So we hopefully have no major accident for now for a long time, and I hope it will remain like that, and it has to remain like that. And the second point is that it would be good to see all the vendors able to deliver the project on time, because it is the main challenge for the future of the nuclear industry.
I completely agree. Stefan, thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Marie.